Okay, so today what we're going to look at is implementing network device security. Okay, so yahan pe jo Cisco devices mein jo security feature hai, okay, jaise Cisco router hua ya Cisco switch hua, usme jo security features hote hain, wo hum log is topic mein cover kar lenge.
Okay, sir.
So first we'll look at securing administrative access. Okay, administrative access matlab whenever we talk about Cisco devices, उसको दो तरीके से हम लोग एडमिनिस्टर कर सकते हैं. ओके, एक तो ग्राफिकल यूजर इंटरफेस के थ्रू और दूसरा होता है कमांड लाइन के थ्रू. ओके, बट मेजरली वी फोकस ऑन द कमांड लाइन एस्पेक्ट. तो व्हेन इट कम्स टू कमांड लाइन, अ कॉमन मेथड ऑफ एक्सेसिंग द कमांड लाइन ऑफ द डिवाइस इज यूजिंग कंसोल.
ओके,
बट अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट वी हैव टेलनेट एक्सेस और एसएसएच एक्सेस. ओके, then when it comes to GUI we have HTTP or HTTPS, you know, these are the kind of options that are available. So how do you secure or how do you protect that kind of an access? That is what we'll talk about in this section. Okay, so okay. When it comes to that, there are various threats that are associated with network devices. One of the most common threat is remote access threat or unauthorized remote access. Anybody can log in into the device or anybody can remotely connect into the device. Okay, the simplest example is by default router या switch की जब मैं बात करता हूँ, okay, अगर उसमें IP address दिया होगा तो अगर आप वो IP address पे telnet करोगे, okay, automatically वो दिखाता है, connectivity दिखाता है, but then of course it does not allow you to connect क्योंकि उसमें password नहीं होता. लेकिन अगर गलती से किसी ने no login करके डाल दिया होगा line VTY के ऊपर, तो automatically without the need of username and password anybody can connect. Okay, so that becomes one of the biggest threats when it comes to remote access. Apart from that, we have physical threats that are available, like damage to the equipment, or anybody can do a password recovery. Now we are talking about आगे के topics में हम लोग password recovery सीखने वाले हैं. So in that case, you need to have physical access to the device. So physically, कोई भी उसको connect करके password recovery कर सकता है. Or else, device like आजकल जो devices आते हैं, जैसे Cisco 800 series का अगर मैं router की बात करूँ, they are smaller in size. Okay, when I talk about 2800, 2900, 3500 or let's say 3800, 3900, these devices are huge, so it becomes a bit difficult to carry them around. But when it comes to like Cisco 800 series or the lower series of routers or the small business routers, they are very small in size, anybody can steal them. So these are local access or physical threats that are available. When it comes to environmental threats, we have HTTPS, like you know, too hot or too cold. Both of these can be problematic for the device. Okay, too hot definitely can damage the electronic circuitry, but too cold basically freezes the device. Okay, like there would be accumulation of ice or such kind of a thing, and because of that, that circuitry can get damaged. Okay, apart from that, like during monsoons, you know, we have a common issue with regards to device that is of high humidity. Okay, especially like locations like Mumbai, where I'm placed here. Okay, here it is very humid. Okay, so agar aap devices ko ekdam sea face ya wo side pe rakhoge, so naturally you will find the circuitry gets damaged because of the high humidity that is available around the area. Okay, so that is with regards to environmental threats. Apart from that, electrical threat is also one of the major issues that you need to consider, like you know, insufficient voltage, that is low voltage, or voltage spikes, that is high voltage. You know, either of these can cause problems with regards to the operation of the device. Apart from that, when it comes to maintenance of the device, that also can pose a particular threat, like improper handling of the device. Okay, simplest example is, okay, India mein jaise aap dekhoge, jab bhi hum log ko matlab device open karna hoga, best practice ke hisab se aapko ideally kya karna hota hai, power cable nikal ke rakhna hota hai. ओके, उसको मतलब इलेक्ट्रिकल सप्लाई में कुछ कनेक्ट ही नहीं करना होता. फिर आपके हाथों में ग्लव्स होना चाहिए. ओके, और ये सब करने के बाद फिर आपने स्क्रू ड्राइवर या ऐसे कोई डिवाइस या टूल यूज करके फिर आपने डिवाइस को ओपन करना चाहिए. लेकिन हम लोग यहाँ पे क्या करते हैं, मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम्स वी जस्ट डायरेक्टली गो अहेड, पावर मतलब पावर केबल कनेक्टेड रहेगा, पावर ऑफ रहेगा, लेकिन फिर भी कभी कभी तो पावर ऑन रख के ही हम लोग ऐसे ही उसे ओपन करने की कोशिश करते हैं. तो उसमें प्रॉब्लम क्या होती है कि इलेक्ट्रिक स्टैटिक हो सकता है या कोई भी ऐसा डिस्चार्ज, इलेक्ट्रिकल डिस्चार्ज रहेगा, तो दैट कैन डैमेज द डिवाइस. सो इम्प्रॉपर हैंडलिंग कैन बी वन ऑफ द मेंटेनेंस थ्रेट. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट, केबलिंग दैट इज पुअरली मैनेज्ड. ओके, पुअरली मैनेज इन द सेंस अभी प्रॉपरली उसको डक के थ्रू नहीं पास किया रहेगा या उसको प्रॉपरली टाई करके नहीं रखा होगा. ओके, तो इन दैट केस केबल अगर डैमेज रहेगा, ऑलरेडी डैमेज रहेगा, तो इन दैट केस दो केबल अगर नजदीक होंगे तो फिर देयर कैन बी चांसेस ऑफ स्पार्क्स. ओके, और देयर कैन बी चांसेस ऑफ लीकेज ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल सिग्नल्स और इलेक्ट्रिकल करंट. सो दैट कैन बी अनदर एग्जांपल ऑफ इट. और इनएडिक्वेट लेबलिंग ऑफ द केबल, दैट बी आल्सो अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट. नाउ इनएडिक्वेट लेबलिंग विल अफेक्ट द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर देमसेल्फ्स, हूएवर इज ट्राइंग टू ट्रबलशूट, क्योंकि उनको केबल ट्रेस करने में मुश्किल हो जाएगा. They will have to spend a good amount of time trying to figure out which cable is where, right? So that is another kind of a maintenance threat that you might face. Okay? So the first thing that we are going to talk about when it comes to securing access to the privileged mode of it would be the enable password. Now when it comes to the enable password, like normally when you try to connect to the router or the switch, you first get on into the user mode. In the user exec mode, when you type enable, you are not prompted for a password, right? You directly get on into the privileged mode. That's because by default on a router or a switch, there is no enable password configured. As such, there is no security configured. So when it comes to configuring the enable password, there are two options that are available. One is enable password and the other one is enable secret. Now the difference between the two is whenever we configure enable password, whatever password you set up, that password is stored in clear text. As you can see here, when they type show running config, the enable password is displayed as it is. But on the other hand, whatever you configured as enable secret, that is always hashed. Okay, it's not really encrypted, it is hashed. Meaning the password is converted into a hash value. Okay, and the hashing that is utilized is MD5 hash. Okay, and that is what you see out here, like enable secret 5. Now, whenever we are configuring the secret, we just type enable secret and the value. But basically when it stores it into the configuration, it's storing it as enable secret 5 and then the hash value. So this 5 which you see out here is nothing but the MD5 hashing that it makes use of. Clear? Now one of the main things that you have to understand about this hashing is from the hash, you cannot recover back the password itself. Okay, meaning you take the hash value and based on that if you try to recover the password, that's not going to happen because hashing is one example which is irreversible. Whenever I talk about encryption, you can encrypt the data and then you can decrypt it and get the data back. But that's not the case with hashing. Okay, so that's one of the main things you have to understand with regards to hashing. Okay, so remember, whenever you configure the enable password, the password that you configured is stored in clear text. And whenever you configure an enable secret, the password that you configure under secret is always hashed. Okay. Now it's not necessary that you have to configure both of them. But let's say if you configure enable password as well as enable secret, both of them have to be different values. They cannot be the same value. But let's say if you configure enable password and enable secret, in that case the secret will have more preference. Okay. Under the password and the secret will be preferred. Okay. But it's not like if your secret password that you type in, if it's incorrect, it will not go back to the password, okay? It will still want you to configure or type in the secret value, okay? So remember, it's not a fallback mechanism, okay? It's just that there are two different ways in which you can define the enable password. One is the password and the other one is the secret. But out of the two, secret will be preferred, okay?
Okay.
In that case, if you want to still, you know, store the password in a secure fashion, you can go in for service password encryption. That's one of the commands that you can type in. When you type service password encryption, in that case, the secret is not affected. Secret will remain as it is in the MD5 hash. But when it comes to the enable password, that is stored in a secure fashion. Like as you can see here, the enable password has a value of 7. That is nothing but MD7 hashing. That is what it's going to go for. But one thing that you have to understand is, MD7 is weaker as compared to MD5. Okay, so bottom line is, when I say it is weaker, anybody can crack that password. Okay, saying that even MD5 can be cracked, but then it is a bit more difficult as compared to the MD7. Okay, but remember, both the passwords can be securely stored. Secret is automatically stored in a secure fashion, but if at all the clear text password, like enable password, if you want to store it securely, you have to type in the command service password encryption. That's the command you need to type in. Okay. Now, one other thing that you have to understand is, once you type in service password encryption, whatever passwords are stored in clear text will be converted to secure, right? But then after that, like in the future, if you decide that if you want to bring it back to normal, like if you try to type in no service password encryption, that will not decrypt it back to clear text. Whatever passwords are already secured will remain in the secure fashion, but newer passwords will remain in clear text. Okay, so just to demonstrate this, what I'm going to do is I'll get back into this router. So let's say for our example, I'll get on into router R1. Okay, so on router R1, so as you can see right now, there is no enable password or nothing configured, right? So what I'm going to do is I'll type configure terminal and then I'll type enable password and let's say I type Cisco. Okay, but now since I've typed in enable password, and now if I try to type in enable secret, and if I try to put in the same password, it's not going to accept it. Okay, it will give me an error. Okay, saying that if I use the enable password, so we'll have to put up a different password as the enable secret. So let's say as the secret, I'm going to define it as Cisco 123, for example. Okay, and now because of that, if I do show run, okay, pipe include enable. Okay, as you can see, secret is already secured, but password is stored in clear text. So if I type service password encryption, okay, and now if I type the same command, do show run pipe include enable, as you can see, the enable password is secure. Okay, but like I was telling you earlier, if I now decide that I want to remove that service password encryption, so I'll type no service password encryption. Okay, but even if I do that, now if I type do show run pipe include enable, you'll see the already secured password will remain as it is. But yeah, in the future, if I create a new password, that password will be stored in clear text. So that's something that you have to understand out. Okay, now, whenever I talk about password, password can be utilized in various ways. Like enable password is one example that I already showed you. Apart from that, even for username, you know, like let's say if I create a username admin and password, here also I can use password. So this password will also be stored in clear text. Apart from that, you know, under line VTY 0 space 4, for example, there also I can type password. Here we do not have the option of secret. For the username, at least we have that option of password and secret, but that's not the case for line VTY. So in that case, in the case of line VTY, we have to use password and the value. So naturally, even for securing this, we have to use service password encryption. Okay, so that's the command line that we can go for. But yeah, there are some side effects to that. Like in the future, if you decide to disable the password encryption, already secured passwords will remain as it is. You cannot like bring it back to normal. You'll have to bring it back to normal by rechanging the password or changing the password to the new value. Okay. So that is one of the ways in which you can secure the password. Okay. Apart from that, okay, this is another thing that you can configure. Like for the console also, you can define a password. Now, one of the main things that you have to understand for the console is, by default, the line console is configured as no login. Okay, that's one of the most important things that you have to understand. Why? That's because under line console 0, if you directly go ahead and put up a password and if you press enter and save it, that's not going to prompt you for a password. Even though you configure the password, it is not prompt you for the password when you connect via the console. If you want the system to prompt you for a password, you have to type in the command login. If you don't type this command, the login feature is not enabled under console. The same thing applies for telnet or line VTY, line ops, you know, any other method. So any line configuration, if you want the system to prompt you for a password, apart from defining the password, you have to make sure that you type in the command login. Okay. Now by default, the exec timeout for the login or the line is defined as 0. 0 meaning there is no exec timeout defined. Meaning once you connect, it will be connected forever. But if you want to make sure that, you know, there is some idle timeout or there is some like timeout value for the session wherein If you're not doing anything on the line, it should automatically disconnect. If you want to define such a thing, that's where you can go in for the exec timeout. So exec timeout here, they define it as 5. Okay, that's the value that they have defined. So remember, whenever we talk about console or any kind of a option, okay, like let's say if I go in for line console 0, okay, and in here, if I type exec timeout, for some reason my access is slow today, but if you need, when you type exec timeout, there you go. These are the values that you can define. Remember, by default it is 0, that is 0 minutes, meaning unlimited, but you can define it up to 35,791. Again, this value 35,791 will depend on the platform. Okay, different devices have different values associated with it, but this is what you can define. Clear for that? So that is about securing the console access. Similarly, for the line VTV also the same logic. Okay. Now, on the line VTV, by default, login command is already defined. Okay, that's the reason whenever you try to remotely connect via telnet, it says password is not set. Okay, password not set or not enabled. You know, that kind of a message is what you get. So that's why in the line VTV, if you don't put login, it's still alright. If you directly put up the password, that should be fine. But make sure that the login command is enabled. If it's not, it's going to give you problems. Okay. Now, let's now talk about how to configure SSH access. Because one of the main things that you have to understand when it comes to line VTY is, line VTY by default allows every kind of access, that is telnet access, SSH access, LAPD, you know, then there is, okay, let me just show you the list up here. Like, okay, so if I type let's say exit here and then line VTY 0 space 4 for example, okay, and now if I type transport input, okay, and then question mark, okay, so these are all the things that are available out here. So as you can see, LAPD, LAT, MOP, PAD, R login, SSH, Telnet, UDPTN, V120, you know, you have all of these particular options available. And by default, if I talk about the configuration of line VTY, okay, just give me a moment, like it seems like my access is very slow. Okay, now one of the reasons could be I'm connected via the Wi-Fi, okay, so Wi-Fi connectivity could be one of the reasons why it's a bit slow. But what I'll try to do is, I'll type do show run, okay, in fact, instead of typing do show run, I'll type do show running config all. That will show me the hidden commands also. Okay, that's one of the commands that I can go for. So do show run all pipe, and then I'll define begin and then line. Okay, now I do that and press enter. Okay, as you can see, a lot of different options come up here, but I think yeah, so if I scroll up, okay, it has started off with line number and all of that, okay? So basically, it's given me a lot of different options here. So, but rather than doing that, I think rather than typing line, I'll type in VTY. I think that will be the best option I can go for. Begin VTY, okay? That's what I'll type in and press enter. So under line VTY, okay, again, it goes in for another kind of a line. Okay, so best thing what I can do is I can type, instead of begin, I'll put section. Section is another best option that I can go for. Okay, so I'll press enter. And as you can see, underline VTY 0 space 4, exec banner, exec timeout. Now in this router, exec timeout is defined as 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. Okay, that is what is already defined up here. But more importantly, if I scroll down, and if I look at transport, as you can see in this router, right now it's configured as transport input telnet, meaning only telnet is allowed. But basically what I wanted to show you is, okay, this router was already configured. But if this router was not configured, in that case it would have been transport input all, meaning everything would have been allowed. But this is one of the other ways in which you can define what protocol can be allowed using line VTY. Okay, so if you define the transport input telnet, meaning it will only allow telnet access, not anything else. Okay, so right now this is what has been configured, but what we are now going to configure is we are going to configure R1 in such a manner that it will only allow SSH and will allow or enable SSH access on this router. That's what we want to do. So for configuring SSH, there are some steps that you need to follow. The very first step that you need to configure is the device needs to have a host name. Okay. Now by default, a router will have a host name of router. Switch will have a host name of switch. Okay. But then the host name is important. You can use the default host name also, but make sure that it has a host name. Now why is the host name important? The host name is important because later we are going to go ahead and create a key. A key that will be utilized for the encryption or security of the connection. So for that key, it's going to use the host name as the name for that key. So that's why I need to make sure that I define the particular host name. So in this case, I've already defined the host name as R1. Apart from that, the next step, I need to define a domain name. So I'm going to define a domain name of, let's say, ccna.edu. That's what I'm going to define. You can define any new domain name you want. So effectively, what it's going to do is, for the key that we are going to generate later, it's going to assign the name of r1.ccna.edu. That's what it's going to define. So remember, whatever host name and domain name you define, that is what it's going to utilize as a name for the key. Okay. So now, let's go ahead and create the key. So to generate the key, the command is crypto key generate RSA. Okay. And once I do that and press enter, okay, as you notice, it's asking me for the modulus. Modulus meaning what should be the size of the key. Now, one thing that you have to understand is by default, the value is set as 512. But if you choose a value of 512, meaning it will enable SSH version 1. Okay? If you want SSH version 2, you have to make sure that the key size is greater than 768. Okay? Okay. Key size should be greater than 768 bits. Now, what is the difference between SSH 1 and SSH 2? Well, simply put, SSH 2 is more secure than SSH version 1. Okay, so if I want SSH version 1 or version 2, I have to make sure that I use the bit size of more than 768. So for our example, I am going to keep it as 1024. Okay, and I'll press enter. And as I told you earlier, the key, the name for the key will be r1.ccna.edu. So that is what it has done. It has gone ahead and generated the key. Okay. So it has generated that, but in a little while, it should come up with a message saying SSH has been enabled. Okay. But it has not come that. Maybe it's because of the... Maybe it's because like it's a privileged router. You know, that could be the reason for it. But as such, it's more to do with like, you know, in a practical router or in a physical router, you'll find that it comes up with a message that SSH version 2 has been enabled. Okay. But now the key has been generated. The next thing that we want to do after generating the key is we need to have a username and password. Like for Telnet, earlier we saw under line VTY, we go ahead and create a password and it starts working. Right? But that's not the case for SSH. As for SSH, we do need to have a username and a password. So that's why let's go ahead and configure a username and password. So I'll type in username, and username I'm going to keep it as, let's say, admin. Okay, and then I'll use secret because password will be put clear text. So I'm going to use secret, and let's say I'm going to define it as Cisco. Okay, now I'm saying cannot have both a user password and a user secret. Now why is that? That's because maybe on this router there is already a username configured as admin. You know, that could be the possibility out there. Let us go ahead and check that. So if I type do show run, okay, and then pipe include user. As you can see, we have already defined admin and it has been defined with a password. Okay, but you're not able to see what password it is, but I'm assuming that it would be Cisco.
Cisco.
Okay, but the reason it was giving me this kind of an error was I was trying to create a secret and it was already configured with a password. Okay, so you cannot have both. Okay, you'll have to choose between secret or password. Okay, for enable, we have both the choices, but for username, you can only either define a password or a secret. Okay, so right now there is already a username and password configured. So the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm just going to get on into line VTY 0 space 4 first. And then the very first command that I'm going to type in is no transport input. What will that do? That will make sure that everything is disabled.
Okay.
And now since everything is disabled, I can now go ahead and type transport input SSH, meaning it's only going to allow SSH, nothing else. Okay. Now once I've done that, one of the other most important commands that you need to type in is login local. If you do not type this command, login local, which means it will not be able to use the local database for authentication. So that's why you have to make sure that login local command is defined. Okay, that's it. I mean, that will enable SSH access on this particular router. Okay, so I've enabled SSH access, but now I need to test it, right? Another most important command that I need to type in, apart from configuring the SSH that I just showed you, okay, if I want to make sure that this router only allows SSH version 2, okay, now that's another thing that you have to understand. If you enable SSH version 2, like I showed you how to enable SSH version 2, right? If you set the key size to greater than 768 or equal to 768, it will enable SSH version 2. But by default, the router allows both SSH version 1 as well as SSH version 2. If you want to strictly allow SSH version 2, if you do not want to allow SSH version 1, you have to also type in another command, IP SSH version and then 2. That will make sure that you are limiting the SSH to version 2. Okay, so I've done this. Now if I type show SSH, and if I press enter, okay, it says no SSH version 2 server connections running, no SSH version 1 server connections running. Okay, meaning it is telling me that there are no incoming connections active on this. Also, if I type show IP SSH, as you can see, it says SSH enabled and it clearly says version 2. Okay, but if at all I had not put up that command, IP SSH version 2, you would have seen that it shows version 1 and version 2. Apart from that, it says authentication methods. It allows all these authentication methods. Encryption algorithm. Now, as you can see, all the secure forms of algorithm is what it supports because we're using version 2. Okay, then the MAC algorithm is nothing but hashing algorithm. Okay, so it says SHA-1, SHA-96 and all that. But basically, it uses secure form of encryption and hashing. Okay, so all the SSH related configuration is what it shows out here. And then it also says authentication timeout 120 seconds, authentication retry is 3. Meaning, if at all you fail the authentication 3 times, it will close the session. That is what it means by that. And the authentication timeout is set to 120 seconds, meaning 2 minutes. Meaning, once you authenticate, it will be valid for a period of 2 minutes, after which it's going to re-authenticate your session. Okay, so that's the kind of configuration that is already set, which you can go ahead and customize or modify if you want. But right now, since I've done this, I'll just type show IP interface brief. Okay, now that's the configuration that I've done. 192.168.2.10, 192.168.1.1, and 192.168.10.1. That is what we have. So now what I'll do is, I'll go in for this particular router here, let's say router R2. And from router R2, what I'll try to do is, I'll try to ping router R1. Okay, so ping 192.168.2.10. Okay, that's what I'm going to use. And when I do that, as you can see, I do have connectivity. Now when it comes to connecting to R2, the command line would be SSH. Minus L, okay, that's the login name. So login name in our case is admin, and then I'm supposed to type the IP address of the router. Okay, so the IP address of the SSH server is 192.168.2.10. And when I press enter, it is asking me for a password. So password in our case was Cisco. And there you go. I do have access. Now, as you can see, the moment I typed SSH username and password, it actually took me to the privilege mode. It took me to the privilege mode. That's because, okay, like on R1, if you remember, or if you remember the command line that we looked at, when I looked at the username that was already configured here, let me type the command again. So show run pipe section username. Okay, as you can see, the privilege was already assigned as 15. If I had not put this command privilege 15, it would have assigned privilege level 1. 1 meaning user exec mode. That's what I would have got. But since I had defined privilege level 15, it took me into the privilege exec mode. And that's why it directly goes into the privilege mode of browser IO. Okay, so it all depends on that particular part. Now, why is that happening? That's because under line VTY, if you remember, I typed in login local, meaning it will use that local database and accordingly it will authenticate, plus after that it will authorize that particular user with the appropriate privilege level that you define. And that's exactly what happened in this particular scenario. Okay, now at this point, as you can notice, I did it using the router, but similarly you can also do it using a Windows machine. So if you are using a Windows machine, okay, let me just open up the session here. So I'll just scale the window so that okay. So this machine already has internet connectivity, but more importantly, it has an IP address of 2.251. Okay, that's what I know. So based on that, it should easily connect to that particular router. So I open up PuTTY here, and under PuTTY, as you can see, by default it shows SSH. So the IP address of the router is 192.168.2.10. Okay, that's the IP address of the router, and I'll just click on open. There you go, that's the key that's thing. Okay, and let's see if at all it's showing the name of the key. No, it's not showing the name of the key. Okay, at least it shows the SSH RSA 1024 bit, and it shows the fingerprint, which you can definitely verify on the router. Okay, so I'll just click on yes to accept the key. Okay, and as you can see, immediately it's asking me for username. So I'll log in as admin, and the password is simple. And when I do that, I should get the prompt of R1. Okay, so I got the prompt of R1. Now if I go into the physical router R1, and if I type show SSH, I should see the connection that has come up. And as you can see, it clearly shows that it's an SSH version 2 connection. Mm-hmm. It shows incoming as outgoing. Username is admin. Okay. And it clearly shows session started. And it's also showing me the encryption and hashing that I'm utilizing. So that is the SSH related parameter that it showed. But if you want to really see what IP got connected into your router, you can type the command who. Okay. In the privilege mode, when you type who, you'll notice that on line VTY, okay, there is a user admin who has connected, okay, and in the device, you also show me the IP address, that is 192.168.2.251, which is nothing but the IP address of my Windows machine. Clear with that? Okay, so this is one of the commands, who, that you can type. You can also type show users. Okay, so show users also shows you the same kind of a option. Okay, apart from that, you can also type show session, I believe. No, not show session. I think it is show connection. Let me just type that in. Let me check, okay? I'm not exactly sure. No, I think that's the command. Show user. And who? Yeah. Okay. No, actually, show session is called connections going through this router. Like, if I'm already connected to Telnet or SSH or somewhere else, then in that case, it will show me those sessions out there. Okay. But incoming sessions, if you want to see, you'll have to type who command or show you. That's the command line you can go for. Clear with that? Okay. So I'll go ahead and close the SSH session now. So I'll just type exit here. Okay. Now that's done. Okay. Now what I'll do is from R2 again I'll try to SSH password of Cisco. So as you can see, from R2 I went ahead and established a session, right? Okay. Now in this case, if I type Control Shift 6X, I'll get back into R2, as you can see. and now but I show sessions, I should see that particular session. Okay, so that's the thing. So if at all I'm wanting to see what are my outgoing connections, that's where I can type this. So show sessions command. Clear with that? Okay. But yeah, but that's the command that I can go for. Okay, and if I type disconnect, it will disconnect that particular session. Clear with that? Okay, so that was the SSH configuration that I wanted to show you. So as you can see, show IP SSH and show SSH. Now, in this case, as you can see, it shows SSH version 2. That is what it's utilizing. But look at the encryption that is utilized. It's showing the encryption as triple depth. Now, the reason that could be the case, like it's using an older version of encryption, that's because it may be supporting both version 1 as well as version 2. Mm-hmm. Okay? It is supporting both version 1 and version 2. So if at all it uses or supports version 1 and version 2, okay, so the default behavior is it always switches over to a lower encryption standard. It does not use the higher encryption standard. That's why you have to make sure that it's used the right version of SSH. Otherwise, you will not get the most preferred level of security. Okay. So that's the PuTTY session that is showing, which I already showed you earlier. But now let's take a look at the discovery option. Okay. So it will be the similar kind of a thing that we already talked about, but just a quick revision. So here they are defining an enable password, okay. Enable secret. Okay. So they are just explaining the same thing. So I'm not going to spend the time out there. Okay. That's enabling SSH here. Okay. So the next thing that we want to cover or talk about is limiting access using access list. Okay. Now when it comes to limiting access using access list, okay, there it's more about like, see, right now what's happening is I've put up transport input SSH, right? Meaning everyone can SSH into this box. Okay. But then if you want to limit it only to the admin workstation, okay, like only admin workstation should be allowed to SSH into the router. If you want to do such a thing, that's where you need to define access list and limit who can connect using using SSH or using a particular protocol. So for doing that, okay, we'll have to configure that access list on router R1 because R1 is the SSH. Okay. Now right now if I type show access list on this router, you'll notice there is no access list configured. So let's say for our example, what I want to do is I want to allow SSH only from the Windows machine, not from any other device. So if I want to do that, I have to go ahead and configure some sort of an access list, either extended or standard. But preferably, I'll go for standard. Why? Because standard access list only allows you to configure it according to the source. And that is what I want to use to filter who can connect or who should not. Okay, so that's why I'll go ahead and configure IP access list standard because I'm using a named access list format. That's why I'm using this command. And then I'll give it a name of, let's say, SSH access. That's the name that I'm going to give. Okay? And in here, I'm going to type permit host and then 192.168.2.251. That was the IP address of the Windows machine. Okay? So, like, just to verify that, there you go. 192.168.2.251. That was the IP address of the Windows machine, and that is what I am permitting. Okay, so I'll do that, and apart from that, I'll also type in deny any, and then apart from that, I'll also put up log. Why? So that anybody who is denied, it will immediately go ahead and generate a log. Okay, so that means I know if anybody else is also trying to connect into this particular object. Now, I've configured this access list, but I have to apply it, right? And here, remember, I'm not going to apply to the interface. I'm going to apply to the line VTY because that's where the SSH connections are controlled. So line VTY 0.4. And here, I'm going to type in access class, okay, and then SSH access, that's the name of the access list, in. Okay, that means into this router, whenever someone tries to connect, this is the access list that is going to apply. But if I put out, meaning this router will only be able to connect to specific devices. That's the kind of thing that I can do. Okay. So is I've done the configuration. Now if I go back into router 2, just a moment. Okay. Yeah, so now if I go back into router 2, and on router 2, if I try to SSH into this particular router again, you should see that it's not allowing it. There you go, connection refused. But more importantly, on the other one, it immediately comes up with list SSH access denied 192.168.2.2. That means it denied router R2. That is what it's showing up. Clear with that? Okay, so that's how you know that a particular access list is being blocked. But on the other hand, if I try to go into my Windows machine and try to SSH, it should work. So 192.168.2.10, and if I press enter, there you go, login as admin and password of Cisco, and there it should work without any problem. Okay, so from the machine, Windows machine, it's working, but from anybody else or anywhere else, it's going to deny access. So that is how you can limit access using access list. You can also configure a banner login, okay, so that anybody who tries to connect into the device remotely, they would see a message. Like here, they are putting up a banner login as access for authorized users only, please enter your username and password. Now, one of the main things that you have to understand when it comes to configuring a banner login, okay, now banner can be configured for multiple reasons, like you can define banner login, banner exec, banner MOTD, you know, MOTD is message of the day. So you can configure different types of banner, but in all of these banners, one of the main things that you have to understand is you have to define a unique character. Like in this case, they have defined the unique character as double quote. Now, why is this unique character important? The unique character defines where the banner message starts and where the banner message ends. Like you can use the at symbol, okay? You can use the exclamation mark. You can use the hash symbol. You can use all of these options, but remember, okay, you have to use the same unique character at the start as well as on the end to indicate the start of the message and end of the message. Okay, so that's what they've done. They have used double quotes here, and because of that, they easily know this is the message that you want to configure. So that is what we talked about, but now, again, a discovery associated with that. So I'm not going to spend time on that, but as you can see in this access list, it's only permitting these two IPs and denying everybody else. So that was that particular section there, okay? The next section of the topic that we want to understand is implementing device hardening. That's what we want to talk about next. Now, device hardening means we are trying to protect the device itself. We are not just talking about remote access. We are talking about the device itself. So when it comes to that, you know, when it comes to switches, one of the most common things that you want to do is you want to secure the unused ports. Okay, like switches, when I talk about it, they come with high density of ports. High density of ports meaning there are a lot of ports on a switch. Like it could be 16 port switch or 12 port switch or 24 port switch or 48 port switch. You know, it could be those many number of ports. And it's not necessary that all the ports have cables connected to it or devices connected to it. Some of the ports may be empty. So in that case, you have to make sure that, you know, you secure them. Like, you know, so that anybody who tries to come in and connect it into the connect the device into the switch port, they should not get easy connectivity to the network. Okay, so that's why you have to make sure that those unused ports are secured. Okay, the reason you need to secure them is unsecured ports can create a vulnerability point, right? Because anybody can connect and do whatever they want. Okay, apart from that, a device that is plugged in into an unused port is added to the network and they have access to the network. Right, so that's why you have to make sure that you secure the ports. Now, how do you secure those ports? The best way to secure the ports is you have to make sure that whatever ports are unused, you go ahead and shut them down. Okay, but apart from shutting them down, like it could happen that, you know, accidentally, if one of the ports get enabled, by default, the switch ports work in TTP mode. Right, TTP is what it runs out there, meaning it can negotiate trunking or it can negotiate access. You know, so you have to make sure that you type in the command switch port no negotiate, so so that it does not negotiate trunking or access. Okay. Apart from that, you also have to make sure that you assign them to a unused VLAN altogether. Don't assign them to VLAN 1. The reason you do not want to assign them to VLAN 1 is because VLAN 1 is the default native VLAN. We do not want to use that. So that's why you want to make sure that you assign them to an unused VLAN and then you go ahead and shut them down. So as you can see in this example, they are typing in interface range 1-2, meaning they are assigning our ports 1 and 2. They are assigning it to VLAN 99 and they are shutting them down. So basically, this VLAN 999 that they are using, they are not going to be utilized anyway. Okay. Now, here they have not put on the command switch port mode access, but ideally I would recommend you to put up that one also, switch port mode access. Apart from that, I'll also recommend you to put up switch port no negotiate, and then switch port access VLAN and the VLAN ID, and then shut down. So that accidentally, even if you put up no shut on the port, it will be still part of VLAN 999, and there is no choice for negotiation. Another kind of security that you can go in for is port security. Now, one of the main things that you have to understand about port security is, port security makes sure that it allows only specific MAC addresses to be connected onto a particular switch port. Okay, so when you enable port security, it will make sure that only authorized MAC address or specific MAC address are allowed to connect to that particular switch port. Okay. Now, how does it allow that? It allows that on the basis of static learning. Static learning meaning you're statically or manually adding a particular MAC address to that particular switch port. Or another way of looking at it is dynamic learning. Now, that's the default. Okay. By default, switch port or switch learns the MAC address of the device that is connected. So, based on that, it'll only allow the learn on the port. Okay, but another kind of a thing that you can configure when it comes to port security, you cannot just limit the MAC address to just one MAC. You can have more than one MAC address on a particular port. So in that case, you can have a combination of static and dynamic learning. That's another choice that you have. And then you can also go in for sticky learning. Now, what does sticky learning mean? Okay, now to understand sticky learning, first of all, I need to tell you the drawbacks of dynamic learning and static learning. First, let's try to understand dynamic learning. Now, dynamic learning for port security is the default behavior. Okay, so wherein the MAC address will be learned dynamically and then it's going to store it into its database so that only that MAC address will be allowed connectivity. But the problem with dynamic learning is as soon as the cable is disconnected from the switch port, the port will go down, right? So as soon as the port goes down, the MAC address is cleared from the database. Meaning what? Okay. Practically, if you talk about it, let's say the employee was connected to a particular switch port. Okay. Now the attacker comes in, removes the cable of the employee and plugs in his own cable. So what will happen in that case? The moment the cable is disconnected, the port will go down, right? The port goes down, meaning the dynamically learned MAC address will be cleared. And now when the attacker plugs in again, okay, the attacker's MAC address will be learned and that is what will be allowed. So basically the point is when you configure port security with dynamic learning, security is completely gone. I mean, even though you have configured security, it's not going to work because as soon as the port goes down, okay, and the moment it, you bring it up, okay, it's not going to work. Okay, it's going to take the new MAC address, meaning it will be allowed connectivity. Okay. So that is one of the drawbacks of dynamic learning. A better option for that is static learning. When you go in for static learning, you are manually adding the MAC address onto the switch port. You are manually configuring the MAC address onto the switch port. Okay. So let's say, you know, you have defined the maximum amount of MAC addresses on the port to be 1, and then you are defining one MAC address on that particular port. Okay. So in that case, okay. Well, the advantage is, like even if the cable goes down, or cable is removed, even if the port is down, the MAC address is not cleared from the database because it is hard-coded or saved into the configuration. Okay, but then the problem is, we are talking about a switch with 64 ports or switch with 48 ports. switch with 24 ports, meaning on every port you have to manually go in and add the MAC address. So if you're manually going to add the MAC address and if you have committed some typing error, what will happen? The MAC address won't be allowed, right? Genuine MAC address won't be allowed to connect. Okay, so that is one of the drawbacks of static learning. Static learning is definitely secure, but you'll have to manually add the MAC address. That's the problem with static. So that's where the best option you can go in for is sticky learning. In the case of sticky learning, what the switch is going to do is, it's going to learn the MAC address dynamically, but at the same point of time, it's going to store it statically into the configuration. Advantage is, even if the switch reboots, the MAC address is not clear. It will statically remain into the configuration. That's the main advantage of using sticky learning. So, for our example, what we are going to do is, we are going to learn dynamic port security, static port security, and then we are going to learn sticky learning port security. Okay, so all the three different configurations is what I'm going to show you. Okay, so when it comes to that, I'll get back into my topology diagram. And for our example, we are going to do this lab on switch 6. Okay, on switch 6, on port Ethernet 1/1, that's where I'm going to go ahead and configure the port security. Okay, so to do this, I'll connect to switch 6. And on switch 6, okay, just give me a moment. Yeah, so what I'll do now is, I'll type in, port is Ethernet 1/1. So if at this point, if I type show MAC address table, and if I press enter, okay, and on Ethernet 1/1, okay, at this point it has not learned any MAC address at all. Okay, ideally you snake MAC address learn karna chahiye on Ethernet 1/1, but it has not done that. Same way, if I type show run interface E1/1. And as you can see, it's configured as switch port mode access, switch port no negotiate, and it actually belongs to VLAN 1. Okay, so that's not a problem at all. So even if it belongs to VLAN 1, still it's not showing anything. So what I'm trying to do, what I'll do now is, I'll go back into the Windows 7 machine. Okay, and from there, I'll generate some traffic so that at least the MAC address will be learned by the switch. So ping 192.168.2.10, for example. So now, as you can see, traffic has come in, and that's the MAC address that we have. Okay, the Windows 7 machine has this particular MAC address. In fact, there are two different MAC addresses on this device. Okay, so at least one of the MAC addresses should be learned. Okay, so let's take a look at that. So I'll go back into router, or the switch rather, and I'll show MAC address table. And when I press enter, so there you go. Now, as you can see, it shows the MAC address learned as 5000000800000, and that's exactly what is the MAC address that I see out here as well. Clear about this? Okay, so I do see that same MAC address learned out here. Okay, similarly, if I go ahead and clear MAC address table dynamic, okay, and then enter, so all the dynamic entries will be gone. And now, if I type show MAC address table again, that entry should disappear. Okay, so it should come back only when there is some traffic that is sent. Okay, so that's good. I mean, at least it's learning the MAC address and everything seems fine. Okay, so now, one of the prime requirements or the first requirement that you want when it comes to configuring port security is the port should be configured as a static access port. Static access port meaning it cannot be working on DTP. Okay, it has to be configured as switch port mode access. That command has to be put up. Whether you configure switch port no negotiate or not, that doesn't matter. But switch port mode access command should be a must. Okay. So, configure terminal. Okay, and then interface E1/1, that's what I'm going to type. And now for configuring port security, okay, the command line would be switch port security, Now the first command that I want to show you is maximum. Okay. Now by default, the maximum MAC address that you can learn on a particular switch port is 1. Okay. But the maximum it can learn on a particular port will depend on the switch platform. Like here it shows 4097 MAC address, but some of them may show 128, others may show 64, you know, depending upon the model number of the switch. But here on this particular switch, it's showing 4097 MAC addresses. Okay. And by default, it's configured for maximum of 1 MAC. So that's exactly what I'm going to use, the default. Okay. 1 MAC address only, not more than that. So that's what I'm going to define. Okay. It's not going to learn any MAC address. Okay. So that is what this command means. Okay. Then, apart from that, I need to type in switch port, port security. Okay. And the moment I type this command, and like if I put question mark, okay, we have all of these options. But another thing that I also want to talk about is violation. Okay. Now, when I talk about port security violation, there are three different types of violation options available. By default, it's configured for shutdown. Now, when I say shutdown, it is not administratively shutting down the port. It is only putting up the port in error disabled state. Error disabled state meaning what? It's going to put up the port in a particular state where no traffic will be allowed to pass through that particular port. Okay, no incoming, no outgoing traffic. Okay, so basically it's kind of shutting down, but it will restrict all traffic. It will not allow any traffic to pass through on that particular port. So remember, shutdown is the default. But apart from that, we have protect and restrict. Do you know the difference between protect and restrict? The violation mode of protect and restrict. Do you know the difference between the two?
Nahi, sir.
Nahi pata? Okay.
Nahi.
No, nahi pata. Okay. No problem. Okay, so whenever we talk about protect and restrict, okay, actually behavior wise, both of them are same. Okay, in the sense, they are not going to put the port in error disabled state as such. Okay, but then, you know, the main thing about protect and restrict is they would not allow any traffic to pass through on that port. In the case of shutdown mode, as I told you, it puts up to error disabled state and the state of the port is shown as secure down. Okay, that is what is going to be showing to us, right? But that's not the case of protect and restrict. In the case of protect and restrict, it will not allow any traffic to pass through on that particular port. Okay, but then in the case of protect, it's going to generate an SNMP log.
Okay.
Okay, in the case of protect mode, apart from restricting traffic or apart from not allowing any traffic to pass through the port, it's also going to generate a SNMP log. But in the case of restrict, it's not even going to generate any kind of a log. It's just going to block traffic.
Okay.
Okay, so bottom line is, if you put up the violation mode as restrict, you won't even understand, you know, what's happening. Okay, the traffic or no log, nothing would be intimated by the switch. But in the case of protect, okay, at least there would be a SNMP log that will be generated. Okay, but we are going to keep it as the default, that is shutdown, so that, you know, it will put it up into secure shutdown mode, and at the same point of time, we'll see a log that is generated. Okay. So I'm using the default mode, and then I can also define aging. Now, what is aging? Like when I touch port, port security, aging, okay. Now, here I can define, okay, whether I want static, okay, that is, I can define a manual time for that particular thing, or I can define an aging time, that is, the MAC address which is learned under port security for how long it should be valid, okay, and then I can define the aging type. Now, when I type aging type, there are different types of aging type, absolute and inactivity. By default, it's set as absolute. Absolute meaning right from the time the MAC address is learned for how long it should remain in the database. That's what you define as absolute. But if you define as inactivity, inactivity meaning idle time. If there is no traffic coming from that particular MAC address, so then in that case, it will calculate the time based on that. Okay, like let's say if you have defined the aging time as 30 minutes. Okay, just give you an example here. So if you have defined the aging time as 30 minutes, and if you have defined the aging type as inactivity, meaning if that particular device is idle for 30 minutes, that MAC address will be removed from the database. Okay, but if you keep it as a default of aging type of absolute, meaning what? As soon as the macOS is learned, the timer will start and it will remain for a period of 30 minutes. And after that, it will be removed from the database. Okay, now here I'm not defining any aging because by default the aging is disabled. Disabled meaning there is no aging that is considered. Okay, and now the final thing that I want to do is I want to go ahead and enable port security. So remember, port security has to be activated right at the end. Because if you enable port security at the start, you know, it will immediately enforce all the settings. So it might happen that, you know, if you have like multiple MAC addresses connected to a particular port, it will immediately go down. We do not want that to happen. So that's why you want to make sure that you configure port security or activate port security right at the end. Okay. So here, to enable port security, the command is switch port security.
Port security.
And so that will go ahead and enable port security. So I've done this, and now if I want to verify the configuration, the command is show switch port. Okay, I think it's show port security.
Show port security. Yeah.
Okay. Show port security, okay, and then interface, okay, E1/1. And when I do that, as you can see, by default, port security is enabled, of course, but port status is secure up. Okay, aging time, like I told you, is 0 minutes, meaning there is no aging time at all. Maximum MAC address by default is set to 1, okay, and then there is no MAC address or nothing that has been learned. Understood part? Okay, so this is what we have, okay. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to go back into this Windows machine, okay, and from here, I'm going to go ahead and ping, okay, and as you can see, okay, there was some delay out here initially, because we had to learn the MAC address, but more importantly, if I go back into switch 6 right now, and if I type the same command again, show port security interface E1/1, you'll see that new MAC address has been learned. Maximum MAC address was 1, and total MAC address also has come up as 1. Okay. Next, what I want to demonstrate is, I want to demonstrate a violation. Violation meaning, I would go ahead and change the MAC address out here, and accordingly we'll see what happens out here. Okay, now remember, right now I've only configured dynamic ports. Okay, so let's go back into the interface here. Okay. So I'll right click on the interface, network and sharing center, and in here I'll go to the connection, and under that I'll go to properties. Under properties I'll click on configure here, and under configure I'll go into advanced. Under advanced we have the option of locally administered address, as you can see here. Okay, that's the option that I'm going to choose, and by default, as you can see, it shows not present. But what I'm going to do next is, okay, now keep a, like, you know, observe this particular section here, okay, because the moment I'm going to change the MAC address, naturally there will be a shift of connectivity. So that's what I want to have a look at. So I'll just click on value, and I'm going to set the MAC address value as 5000. Okay, and then 0008. And then earlier it was 0000, but I'm going to change it to 0088. Okay, that's the MAC address that I'm going to define. So I change the MAC address here. So I'll click on OK. And as you can see, it shows not connected. Okay. And then, there you go, immediately it comes up with no internet access, and it's showing locally the connection, but it's come up to identifying it. Okay, similarly, on the switch, if I go about and have a look, as you can see, it comes up with a message that is port management, TM meaning port management, and error disabled.
Okay.
So it's immediately come up to e-secure violation error detected on Ethernet 1/1, and it's putting up Ethernet 1/1 error disabled.
Yeah.
Now here it worked, you know, this thing worked because I removed the cable from the switchboard. I kept the cable active. I just went ahead and modified the MAC address of the device. So that's why it changed state to down. Okay. In fact, if I type show port security at this point, okay. So when I type show port security and if I press enter, as you can see, okay, it says MAC secure address count is 1. Security violation count is also shown as 1. Also, if I type show port security interface E1/1, as you can see, it shows secure shutdown. You get that? So it's already in error disabled state. Okay? And it's also showing that it's in security violation. Okay? But as you can see, total MAC address, configured MAC address, they are all 0. Okay? And that is what I was talking about. The moment the port goes into down state, the MAC address gets cleared. Okay? Now, let me tell you one thing. Now, let's assume the attacker has already connected, but the port is down. Right? So what the attacker now will do is, they'll call up the help desk, imitating themselves that they are the employee, and they'll say, I do not have network connectivity.
Okay.
The administrator might go ahead, and what he'll do? Like, he'll get on into that particular port on the switch, and then he'll first put up a shutdown.
Shutdown.
Okay, so the port will go down, or administratively down, and then he'll put up a no shut.
No shutdown.
Now, when he does that and presses enter, the port comes up, right? But more importantly, ideally what should have happened is, since port security is there, the MAC address is different, right? So it should have blocked it. But as you can see, the port remains up. And if I type show port security interface E1/1, nothing changes here. It remains as secure up. And more importantly, if I go back into the command prompt, and if I try to do a ping, okay, it's coming up with a transfer page address area. But let me go back into the system here, and if I go into switch 6 here, okay, it does not learn the MAC address. Let me try that again. Let me do the ping again. It's still showing transmit page general failure. So what I'm going to do is, I'll go back in here, change adapter settings, I'll disable the network card and enable it again. Okay, that's what I'm going to do. So, I mean, just because it's an emulated machine, maybe it's misbehaving, but I'll just disable it and then enable it again. Okay, so I've enabled it back, and now because of that, let me try to do the ping again. And as you can see, the ping starts working. Okay, and more importantly, if I go back into the router or switch interface, okay, and if I type the same command here, you notice it shows the new MAC address and the port is still up. So bottom line is, the overall effect of port security is completely missing. Understood that part? Okay, so that is the issue, or that is the concept behind dynamic port security.
Yes,
okay. Now, we'll stop at this particular portion for today because it's 8:55 already. Okay, I want to show you static port security and sticky port security, but that we'll cover tomorrow.
Okay,
okay.